So now we shall start an entirely new topic, which is again the starting point of a big topic, namely relation between homotopy groups and homology groups. So we shall only deal here with relation between the fundamental group and H1. To begin with, we can assume that X is path connected, because if it is not path connected, it will be the study of each path connected component separately. So you can pick up a base point, because we are discussing π1, the fundamental group. So fundamental group always should be discussed with a base point x0 1. Now take an element in π1 of X, namely represented by a loop. Okay, loop in X at the point x0. A loop is, first of all, it's a continuous function from an interval, closed interval to X. The closed interval can be thought of as the underlying space of delta 1, the one simplex, the standard one simplex. Therefore, a closed loop can be thought of as a one cycle. It's a one chain, first of all. It's just a one simplex, but both the endpoints are going to the same point, so boundary of that one will be zero, as a one cycle, as a one chain. Therefore, it's a one cycle. Okay. So, if you have a loop omega, I will denote the round bracket omega to be the element represented by this omega in H1 of X. The square bracket will denote the same element in π1 of X. So starting with an element in π1 of X, namely round bracket omega to the square bracket omega to the round bracket omega, I get a map function, namely from π1 of x to h1 of x. Okay, I want to claim, first of all, that this is well defined. In other words, if omega 1 and omega 2 are homotopic, namely loop homotopic, okay, path homotopic, or whatever you want to say, which represent the same element in π1, then they should represent the same element in H1. That is what we have to prove. Otherwise, the function will not be well defined. Then we want to prove that it's actually a homomorphism. And then, of course, we will prove that this homomorphism is surjective and so on. So, this homomorphism is called Hurwitz homomorphism. Okay. So let us do all these things now elaborately. The first lemma is that suppose omega i equal to 1 and 2 are paths in X such that the composition is defined. That means endpoint of omega 1 is the starting point of omega 2. Then omega 1 star omega 2 is defined. As a singular one chain, you can take omega 1 star omega 2 as a chain, as a simplex, minus omega 1 minus omega 2, this will be a chain. This chain is null homologous. Okay, so this is what we want to prove. All right, so this is the boundary of something. Boundary of a two chain, that is the meaning of null homologous. Okay, so this is the starting lemma. The proof is completely obvious if you look at this picture. In this picture, in this triangle, I have cut it into two parts in the middle, E0, E1, E2. From E2, you drop a perpendicular cut it. This interval is divided in two parts. The first part you take omega 1, second part you take omega 2. So this E naught E1 will represent omega 1 star omega 2 as a one simplex. I have put omega 1 from E0 to E2 here in this way and omega 2 here in this way. So if you trace the boundary of these two simplex, E0 to E1 to E2 to back to E0, the boundary will be E0 E1, okay, minus E1 E2. This way, even E2 is this way, so minus of that one will come. So, sorry, even E2 will come, then here it is minus omega 2 ho gaya, because it's omega 2 is this way, and E2 E0 is again minus omega 1. So, point is that I can fill up this whole triangle. There will be a continuous function defined on these two simplex into X such that boundary is like this. So how do I do that? Take any point here, join it to omega, join it to E naught, and this line you define omega 1. So as point keep moving from this bottom to that point, to the point E2, as the point keeps moving, this will fill up this half triangle. On this side, you put omega 2 this way, so that continues. Omega 2 is from this point here, right? So keep omega 2 like this. So over. So what this proves is that omega 1 star omega 2 minus omega 2 minus omega 1 is null homologous. Okay. So if you are not convinced with this kind of argument, actually you should argue like this to get the idea how to fill up. But finally, what you have to do, all the time I have been training you, that you must be able to write down this formula. Sigma of any point in this triangle is defined. Okay. Every point in this triangle is uniquely expressed as T0 E0 plus T1 E1 plus T2 E2, where summation Ti is equal to 1 and T0 T1 T2 are all between 0 and 1. This is by definition the geometric realization of a standard two simplex, right? So use that expression, sigma T naught E naught T1 E1 T2 E2, T naught bigger than T1 and T naught less than equal to T1 is the dividing line here. All the points on E1 E2, sorry, E naught E1 are given by T2 equal to 0. Okay, so this part T1 bigger than T2 and T2 bigger than T1, you see these two are two different things. So that is where first part I am taking omega 1, second part I am taking omega 2. So then you have to write down these expressions for these lines and then put them there. So T0 bigger than T1, omega 1 and omega 2 is like this. Okay. So check this, whether this is correct. There may be typos and so on. So you have to check that this is the correct definition. This is not a unique way. You may have different things. Okay. For example, why should you divide this way? You can divide here also. But then what are you doing with this division? That is what it is. So this is a nice way of doing it, whenever. So what we have proved is that subdivision, take a path, subdivide, okay. Then think of this as a composition. It is same thing as this plus this and so on. This is the integration theory. Integration over this one, minus integration of the first half, minus integration of the second half, is the same thing as this one. That is the kind of thing that's happening here, okay. So, in homology, this is what subdivision gives you correct the corresponding things. All these things we have been doing, and we will do more sophisticated things soon. Okay. So next theorem is that the assignment omega bracket square bracket to ground bracket defines a functorial surjection. Okay, from phi from pi 1 of x x naught to pi 1 of h 1 of x, and it's denoted by phi of omega f of omega, whose kernel is precisely the commutator subgroup of pi 1 of x x naught. So this is a functional surjective homomorphism is what it says. Thus phi defines, if it is surjective homomorphism, the kernel is precisely the commutator subgroup, means what? Pi 1 modulo its commutator subgroup is nothing but the abelianization of pi 1, is isomorphic to h 1 by the first isomorphism theorem. So h 1 is abelianization of pi 1. That is very easy to remember. Okay, h 1 by definition is an abelian group. Okay, so if you abelianization pi 1, you precisely get h 1 is this is the relation. So let's go ahead and prove this one. The first thing to do is phi is well defined. We have not yet defined that one, right? So let h from I cross I to x be a path homotopy from omega 1 to omega 2. Consider the following triangulation of I cross I. The vertex set of the simplicial complex A consists of these four vertices. I cross I have to triangulate and then take a homotopy and then think of it as a sum of two simplices. So that's what I am trying to do. So a function defined on this one, restricted to this triangle, will give you one simplex. This will be a simplex. This plus that will be a chain in X. So I am defining V0, V1, V2, V3, four vertices, but I have to make it a triangulation. So I introduce V0 to V2, an extra edge here. Now it is cut into two triangles. Okay. Now what I am going to do, take a homotopy. Take a homotopy here. That means what? I cross I to X, I have a continuous function. Restricted to this triangle, it is one simplex. Restricted to the other triangle, it is another simplex. The sum total, this plus this, what happens? That's what you have to see, right? So the boundary of that is going to be omega 1 minus omega 2. That means omega 1 minus omega 2 is null homologous in X. They represent the same element in H1. If the boundary is omega 1 minus omega 2, then you have. So how do you get omega 1 minus omega 2? By the very definition, a homotopy of two loops has a property that on this vertex, on this edge here, it is identically a single point, namely the starting point of omega 1. Okay, starting end point are both of them are omega 1. Here it is again starting omega, single point. If this is a single point, this is single point. Okay, this is omega 1, single point. This one may be any wild arc, I don't know. This is omega 2. But when you take the boundary of this, what is the boundary of this one? Boundary by definition, you have to first omit V0. So V1, V2. Then we will omit V1, V0, V2 will be with a negative sign. Then we omit V2, V0, V1 will come. Okay, so this omega 1 will come. This is a single zero, so we can throw away that one. This will be in this direction. When you do for this one, it will come in the opposite direction. So they will cancel, this will cancel out. This is zero and that is minus omega 2. So that is what is happening. So this I am writing details here. The edge is V0, V1, V1, V2, V0, V2, V0, V3, and V2, V3. These are the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 edges. The two simplexes in K are these two. So alpha, beta from delta 2 to K defined by alpha equal to v naught v1 v2 and beta equal to v naught v2 v3. So these are the two simplex I am taking. At two chain in X is given by tau equal to H composite alpha and H composite beta. Alpha and this V naught V1 V2 are inside this K. This is a simplicial complex. H of that will be inside X. Okay. So when I take sum of this one, this triangle plus this triangle is what I am taking. H of alpha plus H of beta. Okay. We claim that boundary of tau, this is tau, boundary of tau is omega 1 minus omega 2. And that will show that the class is represented by omega 1 and omega 2 are the same. Okay. So restricted to 0 cross I and 1 cross I, they are constant maps at X naught. Therefore, H of this V naught V3 and V1 V2, they are equal and they will cancel out. Now boundary of tau is H of, so I am writing the boundaries here, both the boundaries. V1 V2, V naught minus V naught V2 plus V naught V1. And then H of V2 V3. See, you have to take this order. Okay. So when you omit this one, the sign is positive. When you omit the second one here, sign is minus. When you omit the third one, again positive. So that's what you have to do. V2, V3, V0, V3, V0, V2. V0, V2, V0, V2 cancels out. Okay. V1, V2 will give you omega 1 and this V2, V3, okay, V2, V3 will give you omega 2. Okay, therefore, H of this will be equal to H of V0, V1 plus H of V2, V3 will be omega 1 minus omega 2. Okay, see, V2, V3 is minus, okay, V1, V0, V1 is in the correct direction, omega 1. So this is this opposite direction. So this is minus omega 2. So that's why you get minus omega 2. Okay, so this verifies that it's a homomorphic, well defined. It is well defined. Now, in the first lemma, when you cut down omega 1 star omega 2, namely concatenation, is omega 1 omega 1 plus omega 2, right? When you take the brackets, that will tell you that phi is a group homomorphism. 5.1 lemma can be used now. That's for more generally for paths, but for the loops, it is this loop is the composition inside pi 1. And that is adding is some position inside H1. Okay. So therefore, the bracket omega 1, omega 2, phi of that will go to omega 1, phi of omega 1 plus phi of omega 2. Round bracket omega 1 plus omega 2. So that is homomorphism. The functoriality is something which is totally obvious here, but I will leave it to you to think about that. Okay. So you think about it and write down what is the meaning of functoriality and you to verify that. Okay. So now just for writing the proof, I mean, it's a lazy notation just for temporarily. Pi 1 of x, x naught, I will write it as pi 1. H1 of x, x naught, x will be written as h1. Okay, he's just writing pi 1, h1 and so on. In the diagram, if you write all big things, it will be difficult for him. So psi, pi 1 to pi 1 of AB, denote the canonical quotient homomorphism by taking the quotient by the commutator subgroup. So pi 1 hat ab denotes the fundamental group abelianized, namely the quotient by pi 1, the commutator subgroup. H1 is an abelian group. It follows that any homomorphism from any group to an abelian group always factors to the pi ab. The commutator subgroup goes to triviality here. Therefore, pi 1 by pi 1 to H1, there will be a map. Okay, so pi 1 to psi, this is the quotient map here. This phi, whatever we have got, the Hurwitz map, gives you a map here, gives you a homomorphism here, phi prime. And we claim, our claim is that this is an isomorphism. Okay, so you have to prove 1-1 and on 2. Instead of that, what I am going to do, I will produce an inverse here, and then verification that it is actually inverse is easy. So H1 to pi1 ab itself, I will define a map. Okay, a homomorphism. So how does one do it? So not pi1 ab I am going to define. I cannot define a map from H1 to pi1. There will be problem. But a will nice part I will define. Okay, we shall construct an explicit inverse of E'. So for this, we use the typical calculus experience. Fix a point x in x and use the path connectivity of x. Actually, for each x naught is already fixed, this, that is the base point is there, there is no need to do that. For each x, take a path from x naught to x and call it omega x. There are many paths. You take one and fix it. That's all. Okay. Only thing is, don't make life complicated. So when you're joining x naught to x naught, just take the constant loop there. You could have taken any other loop, but don't do that for simplicity. Even if you do that, there is nothing wrong. But don't do that. By simplicity, you just take x naught to the loop at single point, that namely the constant loop at x. So you have chosen all the, every point is connected by a path. Okay. Now, to each singular one simplex sigma in x, what is singular one simplex? This is just a path inside x. It has a starting point and an end point. Okay, so both of endpoints and starting point, there are paths from x naught, right? So I am going to define theta sigma to be the element in pi1 of ab, okay, represented by a loop omega a is the starting point, composed with sigma is the path, goes all the way to b, so come back by omega b to x naught. Okay, omega b inverse. So this will be a loop at x naught. It will represent an element in pi1 of x. Don't do that. Go to the abelianization and take that element. That is theta sigma. Okay, where a is sigma naught and b is sigma 1. That is the end points. Then theta extends to a homomorphism. I am writing it as theta from the whole of S1 of X. S1 of X is what? The free abelian group over all one simplexes. Once you have defined them on the generators, sigma is, all the sigmas are generators, it will give you an extension to any abelian group. So this is the advantage. If I take pi1 here, pi1 is, need not be abelian group. If it's abelian group, it is fine. But then pi1 ab, it is the same thing as pi1. If it's non-abelian, then there is no need to have any map, any homomorphism here. A free abelian group will not give you a map, a homomorphism into an arbitrary group. Okay? It's bigger, this because pi1 ab is abelian. It's a unique extension of these maps which are defined on the generators. Okay, so I am denoting it by theta itself. Okay, so the definition of the map is over now, theta. So this phi prime and this theta from here to here, they are going to be inverses of each other. Over. So let us verify that. Okay. It would follow, okay, what you have to do, theta from S1 of X is defined. We have to show that theta composite boundary of S2, whatever, suppose a sigma chain, if it's a chain is fine, but when you go to homology, it must be zero. Okay, then only it will define a map from H1. Right? Right now it is S1 to here we have what? Go modulo H1. Okay, go modulo to H1 means what? Boundary. Go modulo is boundary. It must be zero more. Then it will give you a well-defined map from H1. So that I am going to as a theta tilde. Okay. And then you can verify that this is the map, theta tilde is going to the inverse. Okay, so let us verify this and then verify that it is actually the inverse. Take any singular two simplex gamma from delta to x. If I show that theta of the boundary of this is zero, then the whole of S2 is generated by all these sigma 2s, so that will be also zero. Because any element of sigma 2 is a finite linear combination of two simplexes. For every two simplex, I am going to show theta of boundary of gamma is zero. Okay. So this is as easy as the earlier thing, namely, let gamma of E0 equal to A, E1 equal to B, and E2 equal to C. Okay, so these are three points in X. Let Fi be the standard phase operators that we have been using all the time. Okay. Then theta of boundary of gamma. Okay. Look at boundary of gamma is some chain. So how is it got? It is gamma of F2. Gamma of F0, gamma of F1, and so on. So you have to join them, right? But their starting points are all the same. So omega A, wherever they start, this A, okay, gamma F2, star gamma F0, star gamma F1, you got back to the same point, namely omega A inverse. So come back by omega A inverse. Because the boundary of any two simplex is a cycle, is a loop. So already, so starting at A, so ending at A, so you take this one. So psi of this is by definition theta of boundary of gamma. Okay, but this is what? This is filled by a triangle, right? Therefore, this is null homotopy in X. So its conjugate is also null homotopic. Okay, it follows that the term on the RHS is actually zero. You see, I have to take this element in pi1. In pi1 itself is zero. So when you go to pi1 of AB, AB, okay, abelianization, it will be zero element. Okay, thus theta will be well defined. Okay, by definition of psi is what? Is represented by this element, take the loop here and then take the element out. If the element itself here itself is zero, so it will be zero here. Okay, so you have got a very defined map from H1 to pi1 ab, which is what? Going to be the inverse of phi prime. So let us verify that one last thing. Okay, so it remains to verify that theta 2 is phi prime inverse. Given tau in pi1 of xx0, okay, phi of tau is represented by a one cycle tau itself, right? You see, what is definition of phi? Phi is just square bracket you remove and make it round bracket, that's all, right? That's what. Therefore, I don't have to search for some omega, etc. Theta tilde of phi tau is already a loop at that point. Okay. Theta tilde of phi tau is just psi of tau. The same tau will be, I can check. So it's psi of that one in pi1 of AB. You get the point? In defining this map, theta arbitrarily, I had to take all these paths and join them and come back and so on. I don't have to do anything like that here now because it's already a loop at the point x naught, right? So that's why I said don't make it complicated by taking arbitrary loops and so on. When a starting point is x naught itself, you take the constant loop there. Therefore, it is same phi which is already given here, okay? So that will come to the corresponding element here. Okay, starting with an element here, which is represented by an element here, you go the same omega here, that will come to this point. That means what the image of this, when you come here, it is identity. Okay, so, sorry, where I am? Here. On the other hand, given an element lambda in H1, I have to work harder now perhaps, starting with an element of H1, represented by a cycle. Now it's a complicated thing. It need not be at the base point x naught. Summation lambda I. Okay, ni lambda I, whatever you want to write. Lemma 5.1 shows that phi of theta lambda I. What I am doing, lambda I, all of them I am introducing starting a path from x naught to the starting point, then lambda I, then coming back. Keep doing that. Each time, go up and then come back by another loop. Okay. So this is theta, phi of theta lambda I. This represents same element as lambda. Why? Because the extra edge is keep canceling out. So this is like representation theory, you know, it's complex analysis when you have keep adding extra edges. So they keep actually canceling out here, okay? So all the extra edges introduced along paths cancel out in pairs. So this means the phi prime of theta lambda is lambda. So that is a entertaining and easy, but this is very useful result in algebraic topology. Let me take a few more minutes and give you one small application of this result now. Okay, a familiar result, which is not new to you. So to view this, that pi 1 abelianite is H1 helps in computing a number of things. Okay, so let us compute the CW chain complex of S1 cross S1 without going to elaborate Mayer-Vitry sequence. We have done that one already, right? Using Mayer-Vitry sequence. Okay, recall that treating S1 as a CW complex with zero cell and a one cell. Okay, the product CW complex will then have a one single zero cell, two one cells, and a one two cell. Right? That is a product structure. So it follows that the CWs, I should write C naught CW here. I am not writing that. C naught of this, the zeroth part is Z. C1 has there are two simple axes. So it is Z direction Z. C2 is again Z. It's only one. And CQ is 0 for Q bigger than or equal to bigger than 2. All right. It's also clear that the boundary operator C1 to C0 is 0 map because the single point is there and then you are attaching one edge or one simplex with both the endpoints going to the same point. So when you take the boundary, the point minus point cancels out. Okay. So from both the generators here, the boundary map will be zero. So the entire boundary one from C1 to C0 is a zero map. What is the boundary map from C2 to C1? So this is given by the degree 2 maps obtained by composing the attaching map S1 from boundary of I cross I, namely S1 with S1, with the two projection map S1 cross S1 wedge S1 to S1, I have elaborately extended how to compute the boundary map in a chain, in a CW chain complex. Okay, so look at the attaching map there and project it to S1 and compute the degree. Okay, for both of them. Then you can determine what is the R2. Okay, we have seen that the attaching map is actually the boundary of the product of two characteristic maps. That is also, we know that if you remember how the characteristic map for the product is defined. What is the product of this cross this? So boundary, you'll have to trace it first along, say, x, the one coordinate, and along then the y, and then x in the opposite direction and y in the opposite direction. So that is how a torus is defined, by identification from a I cross I, from a piece of paper. Okay, so whatever you wanted to, whichever way you wanted to see. So in H1 of wedge, S1 wedge S1. Okay, in H1, if you just take the projection to S1, one of the factor, this element, okay, will be give you x and then x negative. So it will cancel out. So degree will be 0. Similarly, if you go to y, it is y and then y inverse. So again, degree is 0. So boundary map from C2 to C1 is also 0. Therefore, the CW chain complex of S1 with S1, here it must be Z here, but the map is 0. It looks like Z2, the map is 0. Okay. So 2 to Z, again the map is 0. And after that, it says 0. Therefore, the kernel at each level is Z and Z2. Okay. And Z, and the images are all 0. So homology is just Z, Z2, and Z. Okay, H0 is Z, H1 is Z2, H2 is Z again. Okay. So let us stop here. Next time we will be doing so several of the proofs that we have postponed in while doing homology theory. So we will go through some of the proofs. Okay, thank you very much, sir.